Spectrum wants to hear your views. You can SMS at any time during the show. Type Spectrum, leave a space, type in your contribution and name, then send it to 7197. Your views, our interviews on Spectrum, Radio 1 FM 90.
A very warm welcome. This is Spectrum on Radio 1. I'm your host, Edmond Kizito. On Spectrum tonight, Makerere Dons are battling for the position of Vice Chancellor. What formula is each proposing to deal with the challenges at the university? Makerere University has embarked on an exercise to try and find its next top manager, a move that has seen several university dons announce their interest in the position. The current Vice Chancellor, Venantius Bariamreba, who is in acting capacity, is expected to step down in June this year. Makerere is revered as one of the leading academic institutions in the world, but mostly for its past achievements. Given the fact that it has declined in academic excellence and research output, save for a few innovations recently, the university has structural and management problems that have led to strikes by not only students but also lecturers almost annually. Many people believe it will require great valor, dedication and wisdom to turn around the university so it can deliver on its mandate of training and research. Four people are taking part in this race, including Professors Augustus Nwagaba, Edward Chirumira, Elli Katunguka, and Venantius Bariamreba. And unlike in the past, this contest has kicked off with a lot of pressure, controversies, accusations and counter-accusations. Encouraging, though, is the fact that all contestants agree that Makerere needs excellent management, adequate resources, cooperation from government and the public, transparency and accountability above all, acceptance by all stakeholders. Now, in order to understand the process, Spectrum will endeavor to host all candidates whom we expect to explain how they intend to deal with the challenges at the university. So tonight we have one of them, Professor Elli Katunguka Rwakashaya, Director of Research and Graduate Training at Makerere University, also contestant for that position, as I've already said. You're most welcome, Professor Katunguka.
Thank you very much, Edmond, and thank you, listeners.
Why are you in this race?
Once again, I must thank you for agreeing to host me and agreeing to listen to what I need to say. I'm in this race because I think we need change. We need change in the university. We need change in the way the university is run and governed. And that change cannot come out of nowhere. It has got to be brought on board. I have been in the university for quite some time now, I must say, close to 33 years. So I've seen the university go through a number of changes, right from the times of Professor Kajubi, Professor Rutwama, Professor, the gentleman from Busoga, this Professor
George
Cheria,
diplomat,
then Professor Sebufu, Professor Rubobi, and this time Professor Bariamreba. But what we are witnessing now has never happened in the university. The university has been reduced to an area of conflict, tremendous conflict between staff and administrators, between administrators and students. The environment is not conducive for research, it's not conducive for teaching. We have seen a number of issues with management of funds, accountability, transparencies, policies, and the integrity of the person at the top. So those things must change for Makerere to regain its glory. So I'm in this race because I want to cause change in the university, I want to cause stability, I want to have profound transparency and accountability in the way resources are managed. And these things will come through a number of innovations and processes. One of them is dialogue, communication. The problem we have in the university now is an administrator who is working alone. Professor Bariamreba is not a team player. He cannot work with anybody. His deputies are all disempowered because he has taken over all their roles. So you cannot run Makerere University single-handedly.
All right, we'll talk about that, the personality that you are struggling to replace. Let's talk about a little bit more about your background. What have you done in this life?
I must say, over the number of years I've been involved in administration in the university, right from being a head of department in the 1980s to dean of faculty of vet medicine for about 8 years. And during that time, I really brought the faculty around. I introduced major programs in the faculty, like the bachelor's program in the laboratory technology. If you go in the whole country, in any clinic, in any laboratory, you'll find a graduate of laboratory technology. That course was introduced in the faculty sometime around 1998, and it took a lot of effort. Right now, we produce, the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine produces laboratory technicians for all laboratories in the country, including clinic, human laboratories, animal laboratories, drug laboratories, and that one was a plus for me. When I was there, I also introduced a course called Animal Production Technology. This is a level below the veterinary degree course. And we have many people now working in the area of veterinary medicine. So then from there, I went to become the director of research and graduate training in 2005. And the immediate thing I embarked on was resource mobilization. I remember the first project I wrote was a Carnegie project, which earned the university $973,000. Train people in research.
That's just under $1 million.
Under $1 million. We train people in research, in proposal writing, research management, and also supported students to their PhDs. Following on to that, in 2005, I was brought on board to manage a project funded by SIDA. SIDA is the Swedish International Development Agency.
Yes.
That was a project of $26 million. By any standard, that's a lot of money.
That's a large project.
I managed that project for 4 years, 2005 to 2009. And we trained more than 158 PhDs in the university. That has never been happening in the university. It has never happened. After that, I wrote a successor project, which also supported by SIDA, Swedish group, to run from 2010 to June 2014, also another $26 million. And in this one, we have recruited more PhDs. We now are supporting over 200 PhDs under that project in the faculties of technology, faculty of agriculture, faculty of college of health sciences, veterinary medicine, arts. And the project also brought in money to support the library, support the ICT infrastructure, to give equipment to laboratories in the sciences, and this has been a major boost for the university. Well, when you hear people saying Makerere is ranking number 8, it is because of the research output that has come out as a result of this funding. In addition to that, I wrote projects for Carnegie funding, where we have got about $1.9 million. And that is to build capacity for the next generation of African academics. It has been realized that the academia, the people in the academia are growing old, and there is nobody to take over when the likes of us get off. So we have a project now to build capacity for the next generation of African academics. $1.9 million. This project is providing funding for PhDs, for masters, and I have introduced the concept of funding postdocs in the university. This had never happened before. So I have been producing PhDs, and we sat down and said, yeah, you may produce PhDs, but what happens when they finish? When they finish and you do not engage them in research, that is fertile ground for them to go in other places. Because all laboratories worldwide are looking for brilliant PhD graduates, be it in America, be it in Canada, be it in Australia. As long as they realize you are a competent PhD student, they will grab you and take you. Now, these postdocs have excited the university tremendously. We now have people applying for money. For under SIDA, we give them close to $50,000. And under Carnegie, we gave them $30,000 for 2 years. That pretty substantial funding.
It is a large amount.
People do research, people travel to conferences, people go to the field to do research, and out of that research activity, they are able to save some money for themselves. So it is enriching to them to develop their career and also have some money in their pockets. That is what I've been doing in the former graduate school. And we are still continuing. We have now submitted a successor proposal to Carnegie, also of about $2 million, and we hope to get that. So I've been very active in generating money for the university and also utilizing the money.
Yes,
utilizing the money properly and accounting for it.
None of it has got lost.
Not even a single shilling.
You sure about that?
I'm sure about that. The auditors have audited the books, and these are auditors sent by CEDA from Sweden.
They have a higher standard, a high standard of
absolutely
probity.
You must provide all the information they want, and you must produce the documents. They look at the, and give you a plus. They said there is no single shilling they found missing out of the project of $26 million.
Listeners, this is Petram on Radio 1 tonight. Makerere Dons battling for the position of Vice Chancellor. What formula is each one proposing to deal with the challenges at the university? Tonight we're hosting one of them, Professor Elli Katunguka Rwakashaya, Director of Research and Graduate Training at Makerere University, contestant for the Vice Chancellor. I would like to know what your leadership skills are. We've seen what you've done at Makerere. Is there anything outside that you've done outside of Makerere, either before or something like that?
Yeah, when you say leadership outside Makerere,
yes,
you know, to be able to lead a university like Makerere, you must be a team player and you must show competence to work in teams and in clubs. For example, I was the chairman of Kampala Club for 2.5 years. That's a club of 750 families. For you to be able to lead such a group.
And that's the creme de la creme.
Yes.
The main ministers, MPs.
Absolutely.
Invitation only.
You must have certain leadership skills.
You were chairman of that club.
I was chairman of that club for 2.5 years.
2.5 years.
Yes. And before that, I was the vice chairman for another 2 years. So to be able to lead people at that level, you must have good leadership skills. In vet medicine, I was dean for 2 years. That's eight years. To be able to lead 180 members of staff and they show confidence in you to re-elect you, you must be leading them very well.
A stretch of 8 years.
Yes, stretch of 8 years. In the directorate, I have a group of people I work with. And I work with deans, I work with principals, I work with heads of departments. So I've had no challenges in my leadership at all. And in addition to that, I've been involved in a number of leadership training courses. And recently I was awarded a certificate in leadership by the Research Administrators Society International. This is an international organization based in the U.S. in research administration, where they keep conducting courses and they awarded me a certificate in leadership. So my leadership skills have been tested. And because of my academic career, I went to Ntare School, and that's where...
That's before my career. Yes.
I went to Ntare, that's where between 1974 and 75, and I performed quite well, and they decided to keep me on.
After senior
six.
Right.
To teach the young people.
Yes.
And that's how I came to teach people like Chirumira.
Professor Chirumira.
One of
the contestants is a former student of yours.
Yeah, he's my former student. I taught him in senior two. And these were young people. And at that time, even the Honorable, His Excellency, the President of Rwanda, Kagame, was a student.
You taught Paul Kagame?
Yes, I taught him in Ntare School.
Which year was this?
This was around 1975. Yes, I was 76 before I came to the university.
That's remarkable.
And then I was involved in sports. We were all involved in sports.
All right.
And sports is one of the areas where people learn teamwork, to work with the others. I was a very good tennis player. I still play tennis. I was a very good basketball player. I remember my time playing the army in Simba Barracks. That was the most exciting
during
time.
Idi Amin's time?
Yeah, 1976, 75.
Simba Barracks.
Simba Barracks.
Yes. They had a band.
They had a very good team.
Yes.
And we used to enjoy playing them. Playing volleyball. If you are not a sportsman, I must say, you'll find leadership very difficult. Because then you don't know how to work with people. You even find it very difficult to manage your own family because you don't know how to relate to your own people who are opposed to you. And that's the challenge I have with Baryamureva. Baryamureva will not work with anybody who will oppose him. If you oppose him, he will seek your destruction by using manipulation, manipulating members of council, manipulating appointments board to destroy you.
All right, we'll talk about that later. How's your benefit, your experience, how's it beneficial to, the, if you became VC tomorrow, how did it benefit the university?
The benefit I can see from my experience is one, the stability I need to bring the university. Administration. To be able to administer a university like Makerere, you must work with teams. You must work with your deputies. You must work with the deans who are in charge of academics. And you must empower them. You cannot centralize all the power and all the resources in you alone. And you disempower everybody and you think they are going to work for you. No. What we have now, I think we have moved away from the focus on teaching and learning. And we have gone into other things.
What other things?
Like voting money for employing these communication officers so that they can manage the media and portray the university as the best when things are not going properly. Giving money to employ investment officers who take money without bringing any money to the university. Spending a lot of money in lush cars for the administrators, the vice chancellor, the university secretary, the
pastor. What do you mean lush cars?
Very expensive cars.
How expensive?
150 million, 160 million. When members of staff's allowances are not paid, teaching allowances, they want their 10,000 per hour, and you are buying a car of 200 million. That is being unreasonable. So administration style must be right. You must work with the people. You must give them tasks and facilitate them to deliver. That has been my administration style. I identify a group of people, I give them a task, I give them the resources to do the work, and they definitely deliver. But you cannot run a university alone. Another thing is dialogue. These strikes you hear about Makerere are a result of failure of communication. When you have a leader who is arrogant, very proud, cannot talk to the members of staff. This fellow passed the rule that he does not see people if they are not going to bring less than 500 million shillings.
What do you mean by that?
That you go to him only if you are an investor and you are going to bring to the university 500,000 million or something. That means you will not see members of staff who have complaints. You will not see other people unless you have a project and you are bringing it to the university. But you must talk to these people. Dialogue with students. Come up with student-friendly policies.
Yes.
The issues of internship, you hear people crying about. There was nobody to explain the students what happened to their money. These students paid money. They even continued paying after they had finished the internship. So they were asking, we went for internship last semester. Why are you taking more of our money? And there was nobody to explain to them. The issue of allowances, I hear they are now thinking, they had thought that, you know, government pays some allowances to students to buy teaching materials. And the university, I'm told, sat and said, no, these students misuse that money. They don't buy teaching materials. Granted. So they said we should give the money to the deans to buy new things for them.
Yes.
And the students said, no, we are mature.
They won't hear of it.
We want to be trusted.
Yes.
Give us the money. And this is our money. That policy was not discussed with the students. They should learn from the past. I tried it in 1996, and it almost cost me my life. The students rioted. You cannot take our money to give it to the deans. The deans will misuse the money, and maybe they'll not buy the equipment. But the students are saying,
it's their life.
We need to be trusted.
Right.
So I say, have a list of things every student must have. A clinical coat, gum boots, a thermometer, a stethoscope, and take to task those who have not bought them. But you are not going to say, I'm taking your money. But you take students' money at your own risk. They will ruin them.
Yes.
Yes. So that's one other thing. And integrity. Most important, your integrity must be clean. You should not be seen to be spending endless nights in nightclubs.
What's wrong with going to nightclubs when you are a vice chancellor? What's the problem with that?
You are going to dance with your students. You are going to be fondling your students. So it is wrong. Go to somewhere else where adults are. So that is wrong. And people come and tell us, what type of person do you have? Your vice chancellor is sleeping in Angenoa. He's in Angenoa up to 5-6 in the morning.
Letting off the steam.
Letting off the steam, my God, every day. Monday to Friday. What happened for the university? When do you plan for the university? And then two, integrity. The scandals.
All right, we'll talk about that. Well, listeners, this is Spectrum on Radio 1. We're going for a break. We'll be back. Do stay tuned. This, I think there's a fault, so they're using the Atlanta studio to do the commercial. He goes to Atlanta every night.
Every day? With young students. How do you do that?
I realized there was a big problem.
There is a big problem.
So now you can't divorce it from general performance. He left his woman back. I know Uganda. I've been to Uganda. That's the road behind Rajtura.
Yeah, even if it was Masaka.
Even if it's in one again, that's things you don't do. Welcome back on Spectrum tonight. Makerere Dons battle for the position of Vice Chancellor. What formula is it proposing to deal with the challenges at the university? We're trying to host all of them. Tonight we're hosting Professor Elli Katunguka Rwakashaya, Director of Research and Graduate Training at Makerere University, Contestant for Vice Chancellor. You'll be able to call in and contribute to this discussion. Very briefly, I would like to go back to the integrity point, which is something we cannot discount. But very briefly, some people think you are fighting Bariamre, but it's a personal battle. Is that the case or not?
Listeners, I want to dispel this feeling or this idea I hear around town that I'm fighting Bariamre. It's personal. How can I fight Bariamre? Bariamre is a young man.
He's 43 years old.
I don't want to call him a boy, but if I wanted to be rude, I would call him a boy. But he's a young man. Bariamre was in the university when I had finished my PhD. I finished my PhD in 1991. I was an undergraduate student. I got promoted full professor in 1999. Bariamre had not even finished his PhD. So how can it be personal?
All right, let's go back to the integrity issue. You said it's why do you think he's such a bad man for Makerere?
He's a bad man because he has brought shame to the university. The recent scandals. of the Tracy girl.
Yes, the girl said he had raped her.
The guy alleged that maybe there was rape. Well, I don't know about that. But the fact that Bariyamure agreed to settle it out of court,
yes,
meant that there was some degree of guilt. And there are people he told, yes, that story is right. And we can bring those people, they testify that he said, yes, I did it. But he went ahead and worked with his friend Kabushenga and they did damage control.
Okay,
so integrity is most important in a university because the court you are putting on is a national court. Makerere is a national university, and when you bring shame to the university as a character, the whole university goes down with you.
Well, let's talk about the structures. What kind of changes would you propose?
One, when you look at structures, I have been spearheading reforms in the university since the year 2007. We have drawn plans to reform the administration of the university, the financial management, research management, teaching and learning, including college formation. So the college thing you hear about came out of our work of the reforms committee, which started in 2007 with Professor Bobby and me. I initiated it because SIDA called me and said, we want to continue giving you money, but we cannot give you money when you are still operating the way you are operating. There are obstacles in your university which hinder good research conduct, issues of procurement, issues of processes of how money is handed out the researchers, issues of accountability, because at that time we had a problem of accountability. So they said you must reform the university, and they said you must also reform the way finances are handled, because we want to be able to bring money into the university and be sure that our money
will get value
for money and will be safe. Do you know what happens now? All partners, all development partners, insist that you must open a dollar account and a local account for their project.
Yes.
To make sure that their money does not mix with the university money.
Yes.
So that their money can be traced. But if we had a sound financial management system, money would be put into the university and there would be mechanism to track that money, because the donors want accountability. So we have proposed reforms in the way finances are managed. We must have a sound financial management system. We must also have a sound records management system. Right now we don't have a records management system.
All right. You'll take us through some of the projects we want to do later. But first of all, I would like to ask you to tell us what your chances are.
The chances, I must tell you, I think they are very high. They are very high.
What?
And that is why these fellows are panicking. You know, I expressed interest in this job in 2004.
Yes.
Where I competed against Rubobi, against Professor Bachibinga, against Professor Puda, and a certain professor from Nigeria, and Noridiri. The committee, which was chaired by Ntimba, put in place, in agreement with the Senate, the criteria they were looking for in the Vice Chancellor. One, academic. Two, managerial experience. Three, additional skills of having initiative and being able to mobilize resources and use them properly. High integrity. Very good public interpersonal relations and communication skills. So they interviewed us on all of these for about 3 weeks, and I imagined the best.
Interviews for 3 weeks?
Yes, because we had
different criteria.
Yeah, they first looked at our CVs, they studied them, they called us for interviews, they spoke to us for about an hour, sometimes 2 hours, and then we had public presentations.
Yes.
And they were sitting in and assessing us.
Yes.
At the end of that exercise, I imagined the best.
Then what happened?
What happened, and the trouble I had with the Universities and Other Tertiary Institutions Act, it provides that from that stage, then you take 5 candidates back to Senate. and then Senate would choose three from the five. So when you take the five Senate to vote on the five to choose three,
yes,
what criteria do they use for voting? One, they have not participated
in the previous
interviews.
Yes,
they have not participated in the public presentations.
It's like a penalty shootout.
They have not looked at your CV.
So what happened? You failed the penalty shootout. You dug one side, the ball went another side.
So when that happens and you come to Senate, we start voting with our sentiments. We vote according to our tribes. We vote according to our religion. We right. vote according to it. And that is what happened. Because at that time, I think we were still very divided in Senate. The Senate of 2004 was divided.
Okay.
And there was one group which had a majority. And the voting that they adopted, I find it very interesting.
Yes.
It was not one man, one vote.
Yes.
But they decided that all of the Senate members vote three times. So they vote first round to get the first candidate, the first person sent to council.
Yes.
So they all vote. And then they come back second round and they all vote. And then third round, they all vote. You see, the trick here, if there is a group that has majority of even one, they will determine who becomes number one, who becomes number two, who becomes number three.
All right, take us through the selection process and explain to us how the Senate is constituted right now, the race that you're going into. How is it going?
Right now, we've been battling with the composition of Senate.
How big is the Senate? Take us through the composition of that and then give us the procedure.
Senate is composed of, for one, the Vice Chancellor, the two deputies, composed of deans.
Yes.
The deans of schools, on faculties, though when they were still faculties.
And that's we now have eight colleges. Is that eight deans?
No. There are schools in each college. Colleges have principals.
Yes, colleges have principals are higher than deans.
Yes.
Okay.
And all these principals are represented by two people. That's the law.
That is 16. Eight principals, eight colleges, eight principals. So you have 16 deans.
No. Okay. You have eight principals. Yes. There are eight colleges.
Yes, so you have eight principals.
You have eight principals.
Then after that,
those eight must elect two.
So you have 16.
No. All the eight colleges, all the eight principals.
Yes, they select you. So you have three people for each college.
No. All the eight principals will sit and elect two people.
Yes.
So out of the eight, there'll be two.
Two reps of the
principals.
Okay, go on.
Yes. Then you have the deans. And then we now have about 30 schools, yes. Deans of schools.
Yes.
So we now have about 30 schools.
Yes.
So those are 30 deans.
Yes.
And the law provides that each school, in addition to the dean, would appoint one other person at the rank of associate professor or professor to represent them in Senate.
So that's how many extra ones?
That is another 30 or 30 letters, because some schools don't have associate professors.
Okay.
Or professors.
Okay.
So there is isn't that. Then in addition to that, you have representatives of students, two. You have representatives of people, you have representatives of the associations, like the MASA.
MASA and so on.
Yes. MASA may not be represented, but MASA, they support staff, the administrators. And then you have three people appointed by government.
Okay. So how many people in all?
So in all, you are talking close to 75 to 80 people.
So that's only 75 people. Take us through the procedure. How is it going to be done?
So now, the Senate has appointed three members to sit on the search committee. There is going to be a search committee made up of five people.
To create a shortlist?
Yes. Two from council, three from Senate. They will sit and agree on the criteria and on the procedure to follow to identify, one, the five people to go to Senate. But suppose there are not five applicants, then they will have to see how best to move to about it. When they go through the process, maybe interviews, maybe public presentations, and then shortlist them, and they'll give those names to Senate. Now the act as it is still we expect Senate to choose three from the five, if the five are sent there. And then these three will be sent to council. And the council is supposed to come up with about two people. I still, what bothers me is how the members of council, what criteria are they going to use? Again, voting when they have not participated in the previous exercise?
Yes.
So that is the question mark I still have with the act. How will council members vote on these candidates when they have not interviewed them, when they don't know them, when they have not interacted with them? What criteria will they
use? But you said the criterion is going to be set out.
Yeah, but that is the law. That's the guideline in the law.
Yes.
What I have always argued for is if Senate nominates three people and council nominates two people, then they should give them the powers to conduct the exercise and finish and recommend one or two people to the appointing authority rather than going back to vote. But that is the law, and we must respect the law until it is amended. And we are working for the amendment of the law.
Okay, we'd like to hear a little bit more about your plans. But first of all, let's open this discussion up to the listeners. This is Spectrum listeners on Radio 1. You can call in now. We're hosting Professor Elli Katunguka Rwakashaya, Director of Research and Graduate Training at Makerere University, contesting for the position of Vice Chancellor. You can call in now. Our number is 0414348111. 0312260390 0312261390. Spectrum, hello.
Edmond.
Hello.
Good evening, Edmond.
Good evening, my friend. How are you? Your name?
Yeah, good. Jimmy Alumni.
Yes, Jimmy.
Yeah. Now, Professor's submission is very impressive. And now it is very telling of the fact that in the good times, or the good old times, integrity was the key to have such people in a position of leadership. Over time, it has been overtaken by those who mimic or behave or do things the way the governance that we have today portrays and shows itself. So, one thing I would like to say is that I know the institution of learning of Makerere as it is should think very seriously about the credentials of the professor in your studio. Let's not go by the antics of what resembles what we have as the state of Uganda, the way it is governed. Thank you.
Spectrum, hello. Hello. When you call in, please tell us your name and where you are calling from. Spectrum, hello. Hello. Okay, you seem to be having a... Spectrum, hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir, your name?
Yeah, good evening.
Good evening, your name?
My name is Achibiri, Claudio, calling from Italy.
Yes, Claudio.
Yeah, according to the professor's kind of explanation, it is kind of that the voting which was carried out was illegal, because they voted the first round, second round, and third. So which was the right kind of voting? Thank you.
Spectrum, hello. I'll read out the numbers again. 0414348111. 0312260390. 0312261390. Spectrum, hello? Hello? Okay. Talk to us. Hello? You're live on Spectrum. Your name?
Hello?
Hello, your name, sir?
Hello?
Hello, we can hear you. You're live on air. Your name?
My name is Gerald.
Yes, Gerald.
Yes, I'm convinced by this gentleman investigation, Professor Katunguka. I think if there's no other person who can convince us to this level, we believe this man could revive the glory of this universe of ours. Thank you.
Okay. Spectrum, hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir, your name?
This is Stefano calling from Rungudja.
Stefano, yes?
Yes, sir, I'm appealing to that gentleman who is aspiring to be a chancellor. I think he, you know, is tarnishing the image of his incumbent. I think he should at least try to adjust, because it is not good, because the same way he's doing in case he becomes tomorrow. Because I think the guy had improved it, because he became a chancellor when the image of the university was already young, but I think he's trying to look home at some extent. Let him try to present his programs and what where he wants to improve, but not spending the time in the beginning of his career. Thank you.
Spectrum, hello.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening, your name?
Hello.
Hello?
Good evening.
Good evening, your name again?
Yes, John Perubiri. I'm in Kabowa. How does the gentleman actually expect to tackle the high level in discipline at the university? Because among the practices we have in Uganda, Makerere actually is alleged to have the highest level of discipline. How is this actually going to tackle that?
Okay. Spectrum, hello. Hello. Please talk to us. Your live on air, please talk to us. Hello?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir. Your name?
I want to thank the professor.
Your name again?
My name is Senat. I want to thank the professor for what he's mentioning, but I want to caution him one issue. As Wanyankore say, Wanyankore said to the guy in Nera, he has gone too far. If he is in the contesting for the post of vice chancellor, let him stand alone instead of counter choosing other people just for nothing. Because in the race, it's supposed to be a free and fair race, but not pinpointing. Thank you.
Spectrum, hello? Hello?
Hello, this is my name.
Yes, sir.
But you are still having a problem because whatever phone you are, in fact, there is nothing we get as a feedback. Please try your machines.
Okay, Spectrum, hello?
Like I would say.
Hello? Please talk to us, sir. Your name?
Hello?
Hello, madam, your name?
Yes, my name is Kim.
Yes.
I'm calling with regard to Mr. Katunguka's bid to be Vice Chancellor of Makerere University. Hello?
Yes, please go on, we can hear you.
Yes, I personally haven't heard anything that would convince me that he would make a good Vice Chancellor. He's pointed out a lot of things that are wrong currently. Anybody who's at Makerere is aware that these things are wrong anyway. And he's also pointed out things which have been in the news about Professor Bariam Rera. But he hasn't actually told us what he is likely to do. What can he do better other than being member of a football club, being chairman of Kampala Club, and all the other things that he said? That does not make you a team player. He has to actually bring something more than that to the table rather than just telling us what's wrong with Bariam Rera and not being at club silk.
Thank you very much. Let's get back to the studio. Professor Katunguka.
Yes, thank you very much. And thank you, listeners, for your comments. I think these are very good comments. One, Jimmy talked about integrity. I agree with you. Integrity is most important. To be a person at that level, you must have high integrity. Both as an individual, you must have integrity in your family, and you must have integrity among your peers and your colleagues in the university. Your integrity must be seen to be without fault. There's no doubt about it. And you know, in most of these other universities where we go and we collaborate with, they doubt Makerere seriousness of our leaders, and that's not good for the university. And Claudia mentioned about which was the right way of voting. When I mentioned voting in three rounds, I think the democratic and standard way of voting is one man, one vote. One man, one vote. So if you are choosing three people, you all vote. If you are 60, you vote, and then whoever gets the highest is number one, whoever gets the second is number two, and whoever gets the third is number three. But when you vote in rounds, you know, when I wish I had brought you the voting pattern. In the first round, the Nigerian got one vote.
Yes.
In the first round, he got one vote.
Yes. The second round?
Second round, he had, I think, two votes.
Yes. The third one?
The third round, he had 21.
Something changed in the middle.
So the whole thing was engineered to remove Katunguka.
Maybe
to
make it
so hard. To make sure that he doesn't go through. So in my views, voting would be one man, one vote.
Okay.
I thank you, Gerard, for the confidence you have in me that I could reverse the glory of Makerere University.
Revive.
Because I've been there, I've seen things going wrong. I think I have the plans to do that, the academics. And by the way, to be a vice chancellor, your academic credentials must not be questioned by anybody. Nobody should question your academic credentials, for God's sake. If you want to be a vice chancellor of Makerere University,
it has to be solid.
It has to be solid. Nobody should doubt how you are promoted. Nobody should doubt whether you have a master's or PhD. For God's sake, can we be serious? I told you the vice chancellor as I've been working with, Professor Lutwama. What would you say about Professor Lutwama? Professor Kajubi, what would you say about Kajubi? These were solid people with clear academic credentials. The moment your academic credentials are brought into question, you have a problem. So, that is one thing. And then, Stefan, the image of others, image was already down. Yeah, I want to inform Stefan, and I'm a researcher. I want you to do research. Please, inform yourself. How are universities ranked? People talk about the ranking has gone high. Ranking has gone high.
Yes.
Can we inform ourselves, just for our own sake, how are universities ranked?
Tell us tonight.
Let's go on the web and find out, put in webometric ranking of universities and see what comes out. Rankings, webometric rankings, depend on the information.
Research papers.
On the information they can get on that university.
Yes.
If the university has no information, has no presence on the web, it will not be ranked. But it has nothing to say to say about what is actually happening in the university.
It's a Google search thing.
It's a Google search thing. So I can tell you, if I became vice chancellor tomorrow, and I directed every member of staff to put their lecture notes on the web,
you'd become number one.
You'd be number one. But what does that say about the university? Nothing. And then you are saying you're tarnishing the image of your incumbent. Yeah, I'm sorry if you interpreted it that way. But you must first diagnose what is wrong in order for you to devise a solution. You can't say, don't say that the guy is sick. You must say he's sick, and then he seeks solution, and you treat the condition.
You're sweeping dust, and if it rises, it's not your problem.
No, it's not your problem. So what we are doing is we are identifying what is wrong in the university.
Yes.
As we talk now. So what do we need to do? Issues of student welfare. That has to be tackled head on.
Accommodation. Some people think you want to privatize.
Accommodation halls. No, that is a misconception. When I say privatization, I mean change the way halls are managed.
How would you do it?
Outsourcing. Outsource the management of halls.
The men who run the hostels, Nana Hostel and other hostels, the university.
They're doing it better. So outsource the management of these halls. But not, there may be privatization was the wrong word. But what I'm saying is based on my experience in the university. I was once involved in an investigation of a warden who was involved in getting food meant for students to parties outside the university.
Oh.
What we found was shocking.
What did he do?
There would be people coming to take sugar, people coming to take rice, and he would give them and they take away to their families. So what I'm saying, the university is losing millions and millions of money every day in food.
So when you outsource them briefly because I have to go, you want them to look like the hostels in the neighborhood.
You outsource.
With toilets that flush.
You outsource. You get people to come in. They get management contracts. They manage these hostels, halls, on behalf of the university, on agreed terms. And the students get their money and they can sleep and they can stay wherever they want. If a member does not provide good accommodation, they go to meet you because they have the money. course they want to, the university must get out of cooking food every day and losing money in that venture.
And porridge as well.
Yes, exactly.
So when there's no milk or enough sugar, people will riot at the university.
And
they want to go focus on academics, the core business.
Focus on the core business. Like as we talk
about investments, we have to go. How about the investments?
Investments, we must be innovative and invest. Right now, this Mwasa has a lot of money they got from NIC. There's land around. Attract people to come and invest in the university.
A partnership.
Yes, have partnerships.
I have to go.
Build halls, build lecture halls, build canteens, cafeteria, so that we get out of sitting down to eat matoke and beans.
We have to go. Thank you very much. We have to go. Thank you very much, dear guest, Professor Elli Katunguka Rwakashaya, Director of Research and Graduate Training at Makerere University, also contestant for the Vice Chancellorship. Thank you for coming to Spectrum.
Thank you very much, Edmond. It was a pleasure to come to this radio, and thank you for hosting me.
Thank you for tuning in. I've been your host, Edmond. The Spectrum will be back tomorrow.
Open an ice cold Nile Gold, but don't drink it just yet. Take a closer look. You'll see the rich golden color. Get